The inspiration for the title for the album is the Olympia painting by Manet, as well as the fact that the studio where we've made the album is in Olympia in London. The last album that I completed was Dylan-esque, which was all covers of Dylan songs. And so this time I wanted to make the, release the majority of the album, my own, you know, writing.
Well, Dylan-esque, as you know, is a totally different record to this one. It was done cut live in the studio with the band and was a very enjoyable, quick record to make. But they were all covers. This is back to Bryan's material. The key I felt to the new record was to get Bryan playing piano and keyboards again and writing from the keyboard, which we hadn't done for a few albums.
I think it's a very eclectic mix of tracks. He's covering a lot of ground. I mean, I really do hear something from every period of his career, plus a future thing. I feel there's stuff on this record that, you know, I think it's the third coming.
It's a mixture of musicians that Bryan's worked with before, David Williams, Nile Rodgers, and Newmark, but also this time round some fresh blood.
One of the interesting things is getting some younger players, young Oliver Thompson being the main protagonist, and also Tara, my son, who's drumming, together with Andy Newmark. So it's quite, it's been quite good having new blood.
I realised there was, we were working on a new album, probably when we went to Ibiza, and we spent a few days in a house with Bryan there, with Johnson, one of the producers, and we just listened to some kind of ideas that Bryan had had, and it kind of kicked off from there. When we came back, we started coming into the studio and recording it.
Recording with Dad is different to playing with a band. You have to try a lot harder and be on the beat. But it's great, it's a great honour.
Bryan's son is playing drums on a lot of it and sounding excellent. So it's a little bit different for me because I'm sort of doing little drum overdubs around Tara's groove and beat.
If you wanted to run through the different worlds on the album, we could start with You Can Dance, which was the first track, and it's one that was started quite a while ago. The first sketches for it were very different from how it turned out. It could have been a cover of myself. The first sketches for You Can Dance were kind of almost like rockabilly. And it's been through a lot of travelling, and it's been quite a long journey to get it to its final kind of resting place, if you like.
And with all of these tracks that have been around for a while, was that obviously, you know, working with Ollie on guitar, you know, his input, he's changed the tracks into something beyond what they were. And to have Bryan working with a young guitarist like that has been a real boon for him.
When we did the video the other day for You Can Dance, the single, I realised then that I really enjoy just playing that kind of the riff I do in the chorus, which is just very simple. And everyone called it Maroc guitar or something, because it sort of sounded Moroccan, and that was a feature that I sort of I'd completely forgotten about, and we did the video and I heard it, and you know, I'd really like to play that live.
Kind of feature track, and it's a good opening track, I think. We just did the video the other day as well, which it's a while since we've done one of those, and it was good to try and visualise one of the songs. One of the interesting things about You Can Dance as well is that we have, you know, several bass players on the album, and there are actually three guys playing bass on You Can Dance. There's Marcus Miller, and then there's Flea, and there's Manny. Gary Mountfield, and all playing a kind of a different role. So people come in at different times and you kind of build up the picture, you know.
I was on tour with Bramble Scream and we'd just played at Cardiff University. Came off stage, got in the dressing room, and then the phone went. So I've answered it. I'm going, yeah, who's this? And he went, could I speak to Manny, please? And I went, well, yeah, it's he. Who is this? Said it's Bryan Ferry, and I've kind of gone, oh no, it's not. I thought it was one of my mates doing his infamous kind of wind-ups. They just pitched the fact that they had a couple of songs maybe that they needed a bit of bass on, and they'd been put onto me via Johnny Marr from the Smiths, who's worked with Bryan in the past. So I think Johnny had suggested to get me involved. So as it transpired, I had a little bit of time later that week before we played a gig in London where their studio was. So I just bowled up there. You know, never worked with Bryan before in my life, never even met the guy, but always was a fan of his music. And the way I looked at it is, you know, you get someone like Bryan Ferry comes and asks you if you want to come and play on one of his songs, then why not do it, you know?
Well, all the songs seem to kind of converge finally together, coming from different places and different times. I often have songs lying around for quite a while before they reach a point of fruition or completion.
The way that Bryan works is quite unique. Some of these songs go back quite a way and they've been around for a long time, some of them with lyrics finished, some of them with not. He likes to explore everything musically. To the nth degree.
There's been some fantastic people on it. Nile Rodgers, fantastic rhythm player.
Bryan Ferry and I are longtime friends. We've known each other for now, what, some 20, 30 years, and I adore him. I really love him. I love what he stands for. I love his elegance. I love the way he thinks musically.
I love working with him. He's an inspiring character.
Bryan and Nile, I think, have always been very influenced by each other. But I think they hooked up on Boys and Girls and played on all that.
So anyway, he came and ended up playing on every track on the album. And things like Don't Stop the Dance and Slave to Love. And always finding a space, no matter how much stuff we had on tape, how many musicians were already recorded, he'd find something which would make it sound better, you know.
This time I got on an airplane and flew to London and just worked in a concentrated session.
It just all seemed to come together. The Chic were coming into town. And one thing led to another, and it's like, do you mind staying three extra nights?
Went back home and slept, came back the next day, did all that stuff, and then hopped on a plane and went back to America.
Why's this? Take it out. Yeah, it's a little less busy. It's a bit.
Yeah. Generally, I give him free rein now, you know, because he's got so many different ideas. And he said, hey, do you like it like this? And he said, oh, well, how about this? And so as he's progressing through the track, you try, you know, several different things.
It's good. I could have done. If that's better for you.
I love not knowing what the song is when I get to the studio. And when I leave, having you go, wow, that's the greatest thing I've ever heard.
And so as he's progressing through the track, you try, you know, several different things.
I don't want to hear it in advance. Don't send me a demo. I want to learn it on the spot. I want to read the music. I want to do my job. I'm a servant. I came to serve the project.
Generally, we'll hit on the thing that we both like the best, you know? And it's always fun, that's the thing, you know?
When I got to the studio, Bryan was like, okay, that's great, here's the chart for this one. Okay, that's great, here's this one. Okay, here's the chart for that one. And we just went on and on and on. And I thought I was done. He says, okay, you know, you might as well play on the rest of this stuff.
Yeah, Nile was just so brilliant. His energy, just boundless, and what a great player. You know, 8-hour session, and then we all finish, you can go home, Nile, and he wants to play for another 20 minutes, just jamming. Great guy.
Being in the recording studio with Bryan is always fantastic for a musician, because when you're playing something that's in the pocket, this is what you get from Bryan. Well, you know it's working because he's sitting at the desk doing this. And you know it's right. When he gets that pose, when he assumes that position, I know I'm funking and it's the right thing, because he just goes off into a trance.
There are new players on the album, and also people who I have a musical history with. And Bryan Eno is one of these, and he plays in a couple of songs, Alpha Bill being one of them. There's a film by Godard called Alphaville, which I remember seeing when I was a young art student. And the music of this piece reminded me somehow of the movie. It's quite nice to have cultural landmarks that you refer to, I think, which kind of help to illustrate what I like.
So Alphaville, You Can Dance, and Tender as the Night are all from similar periods over a couple of years. And of course I would meet Bryan again and I'd hear them in different stages. I've still got mixes of Alphaville from back, you know, 12 years ago or whatever. They're really good, you know, just different. At the end of the day, I think he enjoys the process so much, but it tortures him at the same time, that he doesn't really want to stop. So it's interesting seeing him, because he's always just towards the end, he says, oh, I'm nearly there. And then you meet him 3 years later and he's going, yeah, just one more final touch.
You'll notice that there's a Russian voice in the beginning of Alphaville. And that was a girl who came to the studio one day who was Miss Russia at the time. She's like a beauty queen.
The voice speaking at the beginning of Alphaville was because my luggage, I arrived at Paris Airport, at Orly Airport, and one of those classic moments we've all had them where everybody's picking up their luggage, and the girl whose luggage was missing happened to be the most stunning, you know, amazing looking woman. So anyway, we went outside the airport and she had a Rolls Royce or a Bentley or something waiting for her. And she said, would you like a lift into Paris? And I said, why not? I haven't got any luggage. And then she said, well, would you like to stay at the same hotel? I've got like a whole a lot of sweets. Sounds ridiculous, this story. It's true. I said to her, hey, listen, there's this track, you know, that I'm making with this guy called Bryan Ferry. You should go to his studio and speak, you know, on the beginning. And I rang Bryan up and I said, I'm sending this girl I met at the airport, who turned out, during our conversation, happened to be Miss Russia. And I said, she would sound great speaking on the beginning of the track. So she turned up and Bryan recorded her. He said it took hours and hours and hours. I wonder why.
It seemed to fit perfectly into to set the cinematic kind of mood.
Yeah, in Alphaville, David did the feature riff that comes round and round, that kind of funky thing, and it was great to play over that riff that holds it all together. This time's made for love. Let's play together.
By Numbers is another collaboration, this time with the Scissor Sisters.
We were still recording our music in my Brooklyn kitchen studio at the time that Bryan wanted to work with us.
As a fan of music from that city, it's great to go and try and do something there.
Yeah, we're like in, you know, Park Slope in like kind of a, you know, I wouldn't call it a dump, but it was borderline.
No, it was very fast and furious, and a typical kind of New York experience. I like working in New York. There's a certain energy about it. It obviously has a great musical tradition.
Bryan's very particular with lyrics, and when I'm writing lyrics, I'm very a bit more free-flowing, and if something doesn't quite fit, like I use lots of substitute lyrics, like I just don't even really care, I'll just fucking throw stuff around. And so it's challenging because certain things I would just be like, Bryan, like let's just sing something here just so it's there.
Once he's got a complete picture of the music, he then can then write the song to the finished thing. That's the way he likes to work, and he won't deliver that lyric no matter how much he's got of it until he's 100% happy with the music.
He's a very particular guy, and we just kind of vomit music.
I remember we were sitting in the back of a car once, and I had my notebook in my lap, this big, thick, full notebook, and I handed it to him, and I said, "Hey, Bryan, look at these." And he opens it up. He's like,
"You know what that is?
You know what those are? Lyrics."
Also, it's a very good little solo by Flea from the Chili Peppers. He's a brilliant player, and there's a little bass solo, which is quite unusual on one of my tracks.
For me as a bass player, anytime I play on someone else's project, I just want to try to bring the melody to life more and give it a different color.
I always like working with voices other than my own. Hard Hit by Numbers has the usual chorus that I've been using quite a lot on this album, Olympia.
In the way we were, faithfully entwined, in a shameless world, rock and roll desire.
It really is a big privilege to be on such a project involving such talent.
Like. And there's countless names of like different artists and musicians that have come and played on the album.
Yeah.
Ridiculous.
Yeah.
I live for the moment, I long for the day. You walk in my garden, you lie in my shade.
In addition to the chorus, there's he used a treble, a boy, and he sings in Westminster Abbey. I thought it would be great to have this voice on the track.
Reasonal Rhyme and Me Oh My, they were both cut here in the live room. I just said to Bryan, look, I've got all these great piano ideas from Sussex that you've recorded on the piano at home, and I've been through them, and I think these pieces, you know, we need to record.
I used to play a kind of a bigger role on keyboards on the Roxy records than I did in my solo career, really. Partly because the songs weren't mine. So I thought, oh, well, let's have a keyboard player as well who plays a different way from how I play on the Roxy records. So I was kind of doing myself out of a job, in a way. On this album, I've come back into the forefront a bit more.
So they started as free piano pieces with Bryan's loose ideas that he had. And then they've been molded slowly into the songs that have made the record.
The initial discussion was covers, and because of Dylan Escobin, and then there were about four or five covers that Bryan wanted to cut, and I was definitely hoping that, you know, he'd get into doing some of his own stuff again. That I didn't really say it at that point, but he started playing Me Oh My, and that track became very much part of the opening process of this, you know, near 2 years of recording we've been on.
I did on Me Oh My was, you know, I did a few very early takes near the beginning, and then I guess the track started to get a lot more built up with, you know, drums, percussion, vocals and everything, and then later on, you know, I started doing more lead stuff on it, and then, you know, David Gilmour came in and he did some, you know, other lead things on it to sort of finish it off.
That was the first song I worked on with Bryan. He didn't have any vocal, and then, you know, seeing the song sort of progress, and when we finally got that vocal down, just absolutely incredible. Same with Reason or Rhyme. Just a magic moment when he delivered that vocal.
Perfect ending.
One of the other tracks we ought to mention is Shameless, which is a co-write with Groove Armada. They gave me a couple of ideas they had to work with, and one of them was this track, Shameless.
Met two or three times, and then eventually we sent him a couple of grooves and he seemed to get into it, and then it sort of somehow it became possible that this thing could happen, so we gave it a chance.
We all jumped on that Shameless backing track and said, that's the one, write a song for that. So Bryan wrote a song for that and finished up his version with Groove Armada.
We were right at the end of our own record, you know, we'd kind of moved to a point, like a reluctant point, where we thought that maybe this wasn't going to happen. And then literally, like, you know, 2 days before us mastering the album, we got this call from Johnson saying that he delivered a vocal.
He wrote this piano melody on that was, you just knew was hooky, because, you know, he's the king of melody. Then he put a vocoder on top, and the melody nearly became, and then he put a scat vocal on, and then you really knew something was forming.
With him, it's just like the minute you get it, you just think, like, you know, that is like quintessential Bryan Ferry, which is obviously what you want, and no one can sing like that, no one will probably be able to sing like that again, which is great.
A lot of these songs that Bryan's working on are maybe, you know, rock, R&B kind of orientated. Groove Armada obviously have a slightly more dancey edge, and it's one thing I've really interesting seeing is the way his voice, you know, the way it sits on different kinds of dance music. I think the track that he did of Groove Armada works really well.
Oh.
I quite like that. And the days go by.
Shameless was I think, a very interesting addition because it changed the dynamics of things. I think it helped give things a very contemporary edge.
It's good because it's added another dimension to the collection of tracks. It's gone off on another tangent, which is good.
Song to the Siren, the Tim Buckley song, which Bryan did a cover of. Again, that goes back a few years and it's been lying around, and I said to Bryan, this is so good. This is just so good. We've got to finish this up.
Song to the Siren did go through a few phases because it was done over quite a long period. And I kept adding different people to the mix and it kept changing, and then out of this other thing. So it was very much a kind of collage of elements. One of the interesting things I did on that track was I went through countless CDs of whale song, looking for the right kind of whale sounds, because I thought it would be cool to have the voices that were irresistible attracting sailors to the rocks, you know. It's a whole world of its own, really.
Beautiful guitar work from Jonny Greenwood on there. Tara played on it and Ollie played on it. And it's held the test of time.
Hear me sing, swim to me, let me enfold you.
The way that kind of Bryan interacted with how I recorded and how I did it was very directorial and really good and intricate in exactly the sort of rhythms and how he wanted to have something heard and his kind of feeling on how he thought it should sort of come across in the pitch and the tone was truly helpful.
There are lots of guitar players on the album. And on this song, Jonny Greenwood is one of them from Radiohead, you know, great band, and he's a great, you know, unique player.
David Williams, Nile Rodgers, Jonny Greenwood, Flea, David Gilmour, so many fantastic people. And none of them, I feel, came in just to get someone hot in. It felt more like they really came on board the project in a very kind of organic way.
I think maybe the hardest song to get right or get the best balance of on stuff was probably Song to the Siren. Getting that mix right, you know, sort of finding the right sound and everything, that was something I guess we came back to quite often.
No Name, No Number is a song I've always liked from the 60s. Steve Winwood and Jim Capaldi. Very different from things I would normally do or normally cover.
No Face, No Name, No Number we cut in the studio here with just Chris Bedding on acoustic guitar. But again, Bryan just sang that and it suits his voice so well.
One of the things that stands out to me on it is the guitar playing of David Williams. Who had played on several of my previous albums. I'd been on tour with him. Mm-hmm.
that groove, that feel thing I'm doing there, Bryan?
I do.
Okay,
I do.
Okay. Yeah. Then let me do it right. Now will you take, see he got all the
I let everything out, all the mistakes.
He ain't taped all day but the mistakes. Let's go.
And anyway, he tragically died last year. So it's a great sort of I suppose memorial or testament to his talent. His playing is very very beautiful on this track, I think.
It's changed format quite a few times. It's a difficult, it's not a standard arrangement to a song. It's a very different arrangement. But I think we captured the mood of it, and I think Bryan sings it superb.
No Face, No Name, No Number, we've mixed the track. Still something not quite happening, and then Ollie came in one evening to Sofa Sound, and we recorded him playing a few guitar solos over it, and then and finally he delivered that sort of great moment that really brought the track to life.
Playing was very important on that because he did all the wah parts, which is very prominent when you hear it in the mix.
It's very kind of maybe a low-key interpretation of the song, but it seems to have its place in the collection. EF bass, subtitled Ode to Olympia, is a co-write with Phil Manzanera. It's called EF bass because the origination of the song came from me fiddling around on a bass guitar.
Bryan said he wasn't happy with the bass sort of combination on it, so he got Manny in, pretty early on. That was a great day. He's a wonderfully energetic player, dangerous. And dangerous sounding, that is.
I listened to what was there when I had the initial run through. It sounded a little bit busy, what the bass was doing. So I just decided to maybe strip it back and just do something a bit more linear with the bass, which I think served to enhance the voice a little bit more, maybe. Maybe it added more weight to the dynamic of Bryan's voice on it.
It was a great bass line, but the arrangement of that one proved tricky. Bryan wrote the chorus for that quite early on, which proved to be a bit of a stumbling block for him lyrically because he was struggled then to finish the rest of the song. But he eventually did, and once we got the arrangement right, I think it all clicked into place for him.
It's a special song which hears a lot of the different various musicians that have been involved really showing off and having their kind of having their time.
Facebook. I first worked with Marcus Miller in 83-84, and that's when we did Boys and Girls. Fantastic musician and one of the most inspiring people I've ever worked with.
I dig Bryan so much, man, that I find myself giving, you know, as much as I can to his situation. You know what I mean? I mean, I've known Bryan for a long time now. We played Live Aid together, you know, that big Bob Geldof benefit concert. We were in the UK, I think it was at Wembley, with Andy Newmark and David Gilmour and Johnny Mars and Bryan and myself. So I've known him a long time. So when he calls me, man, I don't just come in with the bass going, you know, where's the music? We the bass, man. I'm trying to give him some flavor, you know, trying to make it nice.
The great thing about Marcus now, as in the beginning with him actually, I never really had to give any instruction, really, any direction. He seemed to be on the same wavelength.
If he likes what you're doing, he's happy to let you groove away, Bryan, you know? If he feels like I'm on the right track, he'll just let me go.
Just so musically fluent, and so there was a kind of combination of skill and emotion. Just great flair, you know, in the playing, but not show-off. As a singer, you kind of get to be very particular about bass parts because the bass is down there as a kind of foundation. And so you want the bass notes to be true and you want them to be the right notes played in the right feel at the right time. And Marcus does all of these things beautifully. One of the great highlights of the record for me was Marcus's playing on Reason or Rhyme, which is one of the better songs that I'd written in later years, as it were. He did this wonderful bass performance. I sometimes feel that we don't make the instrumental passages long enough, but this is a kind of really, it's one where you can just get absorbed in the music, hopefully. It's probably, I feel, about the kind of cornerstone of the album. Quite like the piano playing on it. The bass playing is beautiful.
Instrumental, we were we actually thought the track maybe we'd have to save it for another a future release, but just a few days before we had to deliver the record, I got a call, bank holiday Monday, we're ready to do a vocal.
It's made the difference. That song of Me and My has made the difference in terms of the balance of the record. It really sounds like the classic Bryan Ferry album now.
We tried putting some samples of some dialogue in the instrumental section, and it's like, oh, it's good, it's not quite working. So Hannah came down, did some ad-libs, we put it through a 301. Bryan was doing it live as she was singing, so like dubbing it, really great.
Simple song, but it's probably my favorite cut on the album. The sun, the moon, and all the stars, everybody. Last track, Tender as the Night, it's another co-write with Dave Stewart. And once again, it went through many manifestations. In the end, we went for the version which has very beautiful piano by Steve Naive, very simple guitar, Holly Thompson, and some kind of radio ham sound effects. It made a beautiful kind of setting for the song, I thought.
Locked into how he wants the song to sound, he'll sing that every time exactly the same way. I mean, you watch him in a live performance and he sings the same, intonations, everything is identical every time because he knows that's how he wants it to be. And he knows that every piece of music is going to fit around that and it'll just feel right.
It's a lovely phrase, tender as a night. So I thought I must get this into a song one day and did finally. Tender is the night, I'm frantic today. For me, this is like an important record. A lot of people have worked very hard on it for quite a while. I'm frantic today. Thought, well, we've got to have a great cover, and the ideal girl to have on the cover was Kate Moss, and when we asked her and she said, yeah, I'd love to, that was fantastic. Kate is the modern femme fatale. She's the most important visual icon since Marilyn Monroe. So look out.